Thank you for joining us for another power-packed message from Dr. Myles Munroe, provided by Munroe Global Incorporated and MunroeGlobal.com. We transform followers into leaders and leaders into agents of change. We hope that this message is a blessing to you as you advance your life and discover your purpose. Now, let's go into the message.
Principles, laws, traditions, and commands. I think another word to use for command, the word commandments. All of these words are found in the Bible. Most of these words have been considered to be synonymous, but they are not. And as we focus on how kingdom citizens live in God's country, we must understand that the foundation of any nation is law. And so we need to appreciate the difference between law, principles, commandments, and traditions, so that we're not confused. I want to begin today with a few important statements. I want to talk about a big picture right now. And I hope that you will get this. If you understand this, you'll be able to tell anybody about the good news of the kingdom of God. Listen carefully. God's original plan is important to understand. First of all, God's plan was to establish the nation of heaven on earth through his children, mankind. That concept is called colonization. God's original plan was to establish the nation of heaven, that's where he lives, on earth. That's what he made. When a kingdom established its extension to a distant territory, that concept is called colonization. Number two, write this one down. God's plan was to establish a community of heaven on earth. That is what kingdoms do when they colonize. They establish their community in a distant land. Number three, God's original plan was to fill the earth with the culture of heaven. His plan was to fill the earth with the culture of heaven. And this is the most practical side of colonization. In the Bahamas, we speak English because we were colonized by a British kingdom. Right next to us is Cuba. They speak Spanish because they were colonized by a Spanish kingdom from Europe. And right next to us to the east is Haiti. They speak French and Creole, which is because they were colonized by the Kingdom of France. So we got three countries right next to each other, but they were formerly colonies, and each one of them are different because their kingdoms were different, so they speak different languages, eat different foods, they even have different architecture, and their culture is different. When a kingdom colonizes a territory, it takes on the culture of that kingdom. God's plan was for earth to take on the culture of heaven. Number four, God's plan was to govern heaven, to govern earth, rather, from heaven through the domination of man on earth. This is found very clear in the first book in the Bible, the first chapter. God said, let us make man in our own image and our likeness, and let them have what? Dominion over what? The earth. And then he specifically stated what we are to dominate. The fish, the birds, the animals. Then it says all the earth. Well, that means everything that's in the earth, plants. And then he says everything that creeps upon the ground, all the insects, all the reptiles, the birds. He said have dominion over the earth. That means he wants mankind to be the dominant culture on earth. Where did man come from? Man came from God. God is in heaven. So he was sent to earth to make heaven the dominant culture. This is what kingdoms do when they colonize. And number five, God's plan was to establish a holy, heavenly nation on earth. Please write this one down. That concept is the key to the theme this year. God's plan was to do what? Establish a heavenly, holy nation on earth. This concept has not been understood by most of what we call Christianity. Christianity is a religion that focuses more on preparing people to leave earth and go to heaven. The kingdom of God is more focused on heaven coming to earth, which is reversed from the theology that has been distributed and disseminated through the Christian religion. So when Jesus came to earth, he didn't come to take us to heaven. His focus was to bring heaven to earth. As a matter of fact, when he prayed, he says, when you pray, don't pray to go to heaven. He said, pray like this: Our Father who is where? In heaven. Holy is your name. And then he says, your request should be, let your kingdom come and your will be done where? On earth. How? Just like it is in heaven. He says, you pray not to leave earth to go to heaven, but you pray for heaven to come to earth. So his plan was to establish a holy nation culture of heaven on earth. Now this helps us understand what I call the secrets to national development. Please write this down. Number one, the key to success in life is law. Life was designed for your success, and the way you succeed in any kind of experience in life is you must know, everybody say no, you must understand, everybody say understand, you must apply, say apply, and you must practice, everybody say practice, laws and principles and commands and decrees of God. If I were to explain the success in my life, it's simply because I followed this process since I was 14 years old. My hunger for the law of God developed when I was 13. So I began to read the Bible when I was 14. I read the entire Bible when I was 14 years old. Didn't understand 90% of it, but that was not important to me. I took a whole year, and every day I read a chunk of scripture from the Old Testament, a chunk from the New Testament, as a teenager. And when I was 15, I began to understand it again. And every year I read the Bible through from January to December, because I had a hunger for the laws of God. Now, the secret of success in life, old person and young person, is, please follow the words carefully. First, to know the principles. First word is knowledge. You got to know them. You cannot know what you do not learn. Then you must do what? Understand them. You can't apply what you don't understand. That's why we're teaching the laws of God. Then you cannot understand without being capable of applying and practicing. Now, applying is one thing. Practicing is different. You know, you can apply a teaching on prayer by praying one day. Yes? Someone tells you that prayer is important. Prayer is a priority. Prayer is very essential. You say, okay, I agree with that. So you understand that. Then it says, you pray, you know, your life becomes more in tune with God. That's the benefit. So you say, okay, I'm going to pray. And then you decide, okay, I'm going to start praying tonight. So you put time aside and you pray. That's called applying. You're still not practicing. What are you going to do tomorrow? And the next day? And the next day? You may pray once. That means you applied it, but you don't practice it. You don't pray no more. Jesus said, if any man hears my laws and practices them, practice means daily, every day for the rest of your life. Are you with me? Someone said, okay, you want to lose 10 pounds? Good. Then stop eating this, stop eating that, and exercise. Whoa, yippee. So you stop eating this for one day, and you exercise that whole day, and the next 3 weeks, you ain't done nothing. You applied what you heard, but you didn't what? Practice. Practice. And Christ was very specific. He says, if any man practice my laws, he shall have good success. Sometimes we blame God for our failures. Well, I paid tithes last week and I get no blessing this week. God said, you applied, you didn't practice. You even paid tithes for the next 6 months. And so we must be careful that God doesn't want a life. He wants a lifestyle. There's a difference.
know, Brother Randy, looking at you now, I think about you as a coach. Randy is a coach, a sports coach. And he would tell you that many athletes come into his care, and they are very good at what they do, and they may have a good game. And he'd say, okay, I want you to run 5 laps for the next 3 days to get your knees in order or something. And those guys don't do it. In other words, they're good, but they won't practice, right? And they end up being rusty and actually causing the team to fail because they didn't practice what they knew. So we must not just know the laws of God or not just understand them, not just apply them, we must practice them. What must we practice? Principles, laws, commandments, decrees of God. All right, let's take a look at this. Laws guarantee success. Sit up with me. You know, I wish I could pound it in your head. I know I've been saying it, but the Holy Spirit keeps telling me, don't stop saying it. We think that success is a matter of scheming. Or maybe success is a product of conniving, manipulating people. Listen, jail is full of those people. There's no instant success. You know about that, right? You got to be training all the time, practicing. Success is a journey. It's not a destination. Success is how you constantly keep overcoming your temptation to quit. Success is how you constantly pursue your dream, even though it seemed to be taking a long time. I experienced a major success early in my life because I started early. So don't be jealous of me, you know. Don't go behind me. I started when I was 14. I started preaching, sharing my life with the people. At 15, I started, you know, really working in the community, sharing with the people. Matter of fact, with my parents, we started 9 and 10, 11 year old. We started, you know, helping the old people. My mother and father had us handing out bikes to the old people. We were, our whole family, we started ministering with little kids. Some of y'all got saved when you're 30. Half my life was already in God by the time you got saved. And so it's quick to get jealous of a person who paid a price you don't know about. So you need to practice, because success is a result of laws. Yeah, all right, let me show you how this works. The power of laws. Laws are so powerful. I want to give you these definitions so that when you see these words again, you'll know the difference. There are four words I want you to write down. The fifth one I want to talk about briefly. The first word is principles. Principles are called first law. As a matter of fact, the word prince, if you write it down by itself, it means first. That's what the word means, prince. It means first. Normally when a king has a child, the child is called a prince, or if it's a female, it's called a princess. The word prince means first, and they call the son first, or prince, because he's first in line for the throne. They call the female princess because she's first in line for the throne. Prince means first. Principle means first law. First law is the law that was inherent in the product when the manufacturer made it. That's why it's called first law. Whoever creates a thing puts in it the principle for how it works. That's why principles are important. They are most important. As a matter of fact, the word that comes before principle is precept. Precept is the thought. Principle is when the thought becomes an established function. So principles are key. Principles are sometimes invisible. They are not even written, but they are built in. For example, the first law of a seed. The first principle of the seed is it needs soil and water. Now, there's no book that tells you to do that. It's built into the seed. So you don't need to actually be told what to do with the seed. The seed kind of tells you by the nature of what it is. If you give me soil and water, I'll bring a tree. That's the principle. So the principle is the first law built into something by the manufacturer. Therefore, principles are critical. You must learn them fast because principles are inherent. You don't create them. The product comes with them. The principle of your car is unleaded gasoline. When they designed the car, they designed it for unleaded gasoline. So that principle of fuel is built into the car. You can't change a principle. You can't decide, I'm going to put orange juice in my car tank because I like orange juice. The car will malfunction because you violated what? Principle. Now this, I want to focus on this hard because if people ask me, Dr. Munroe, why do you seem to be so wise or smart or intelligent? I ain't smart. What I did as a young man and still do as an older man is I keep learning the principles. Once you know principles, you become smarter than those who know facts. So David says, O Lord, teach me thy precepts, show me thy principles, he says, and I will be wiser than my teachers. And he says, I will be wiser than the elders. Because elders may know, number five, tradition, but they may have forgotten the principle. The second word is the word what? Law. Law is established principles. Principle is the inherent concept or precept for function. Law is when you establish it. Laws are established. You can't change them. So the law of operating your car is you need gasoline. That's a law. So laws are established principles. If you know law but don't know the principle that created the law doesn't benefit you. That's why number three is important. It was a commandment. Write that down. The word commandment is what I call, and what it is spoken law or declared law. The principle is the essence of the thing. The law is the established principle. The command is when you speak it. The Bible says something very interesting to explain this. Let me explain this. My father, the 11 folks, kids in my family, my brother died. But I kept wondering, how did my parents bring us up so well? I mean, how do you take 11 kids and they all come out decent? Nobody went to jail, you know. Nobody killed anybody. Sometimes it felt like it, but we had a wonderful home. And I figured out, it took me years to figure out why. I was reading the book of Proverbs, which is a very important book that everyone should read over and over again every year. But that book is filled with these words right here. Principles, laws, commands, and decrees. And I discovered that my father and mother practiced something that I saw in the Bible. The Bible says, the husband and wife, it says, son, listen to the instructions of your father. They're very specific. Instructions is the law, established law. Then it says, and listen to the commands of your mother. Different word in Hebrew. Look at two words. Listen to the laws of your father, instructions, and the commands of your mother. Pronouncement. What does it mean? It means, before the father leaves the house, he gives instructions. My father was good at that. He'd say, okay, everybody up. When you come out of school, you wash the dishes. You take the garbage out. You clean the yard. You paint. Give us instruction. And then he goes to work. Now my mother is home by herself. We all come home and all these children in the house. And she had to get them to do what daddy said in his absence. What does she do? She doesn't give us instructions. Why? They already given. So she would say, you wash the dishes, go. You go paint the house. You go clean the yard. And we react.
I don't feel like cleaning the dishes.
I don't feel like painting.
I'll do it later.
And my mother would say, do you remember what your father said? Now what she did was she went from the instruction and made a command. Commands are only as powerful as the instructions that back them up. Instructions come from authority. One of the reasons why our homes are having challenges, you know, many of them, is because there's no instructor in the house. So we got a woman trying to give commands without no instructions backing her up. And so we have these young people, especially, you know, teenage ones, who would talk back at their mother and father, or their mother rather, because there's no instructor to say, look, don't you remember what your father said? What made us afraid to disobey mom is she had that power to say, I'm going to tell your dad about you. We know that meant they're going to be a whooping. See, that strength was there. So in his absence, I cleaned the dishes, grumbling all the way through. But the power of her command was the instructions that back to them. The law. You ever heard this? I'm going to lay the law down in this house. It's very, very challenging to not understand this. So the difference between a law and a command is the law and the instructions are spoken. The command is repeated. You know why the Ten Commandments are called the Ten Commandments? Because God spoke them first to a man. And no one was there. Moses. When he came down from the mountain, they became what? Commands. And now you got to tell them what God said. Now when he wrote it, it becomes what? A decree. A decree is when you write the law on paper and establish it as a king does. A decree is a written law. Kings would make statements and they'd be written down as decrees. Once you have a decree, it cannot be changed. I like what Pilate said. You know, Pilate was representing a king when he crucified Jesus. And he wrote on a piece of paper, King of Kings. King of the Jews or something, the King of the Jews. And the Jews became very offended. They says, he's not our king. Take that down. And Jesus said, I can't do that. I mean, the Pilate said, I can't do that because I represent the king. What I have written, I have written, he says. It's a decree. This is why the book in your hand is so serious. These are not suggestions. The Bible is not a book of recommendations. It's a book of decrees. These cannot be changed. No matter what people tell you about the Bible, you know, it's the old people's fables. You know, the Bible is just, you know, just old stories. All the stuff they say about the Bible, let me tell you something. They still can't change the truth of this book. Do you know why people hate the Bible? We hate the Bible because the Bible exposes us too effectively. We hate it because it is so right. It cannot be changed. And so it's important for us to understand the difference between principles, laws, commandments, and decrees. Now the fifth one is tradition. Right? What's a tradition? Tradition is, write this down, a conscious or an unconscious custom that comes from a law. And what I mean by this one is very dangerous. The law of the Lord says, thou shalt not steal. Okay, that's an instruction that came from God. It becomes a command written on paper, decree. Thou shalt not take what is not rightfully yours. That means do not thief. Okay, that's a law. And it becomes a decree, it's written. Now, we're supposed to develop a tradition of not stealing. So it becomes a custom. We don't steal. Now, As long as the law doesn't become a tradition, it is open for negotiation. In other words, I don't steal except it is necessary. You ever heard that? I read a story in the newspaper on my way back here last night in the Miami Herald. And they say that this guy walked into a store with a gun. And he held up a young lady. You heard the story? And the young lady started telling him about Jesus. And the fellow had the gun and says, I'm a Christian too. That's such a funny story. He said, I'm a Christian too. She said, you're a Christian? He said, yes, I go to church. And then she said, what church you go to? He told her, she said, oh, Jesus, I visit that church very often. I know your pastor. He said, yes, Pastor Bob. Yeah, Pastor Bob. Then he got the gun. He said, you know something? I really don't want me doing this, you know. She said, but Jesus can help you. You know, you just got to, you know, give your life to him again and don't get back, go back to church, you know. He says, yeah, you're right, you know, I shouldn't be doing this. He said, but you know how it is. He said, man, I don't want to do this, but, you know, I have to do this. The guy's trying to steal and rob the woman. And she told him about Jesus. My issue is this. He says he's a Christian, born again, but he has the teeth. Which means he knows number one, he knows number two, he knows number three, even though number four. But it hasn't become a custom of not stealing. Can I put it this way? If you got to think about not doing something, you ain't there yet. When holiness becomes your first nature, not your second nature, you still have some work to do. Yeah. A woman wink at you, brother, and you married or not married. What is your first thought? She wink at you, man, you know, nice little wink at you in the airport, just wink. What's your first response? Tells me where you're at. Is it a tradition that you do not compromise your commitment to your wife? Or are you going to have a second thought? Do you walk over and rest around and sit by her and order a cup of coffee because you feel thirsty suddenly? You know, you need some help. Yeah. So, when tradition is dangerous. Tradition is man's experience with the law. Tradition can come from an instruction that God gave you. You obeyed it, but then God gave you another instruction after that, but you decided to keep the first one. That can become a tradition. And you start to trade it to the other generations. As a matter of fact, look at the word tradition. The word trade is in it. Trading is, man, I had an experience with the law, and it worked so well for me that I want to give you the experience. Let me write this down. Never transfer traditions. You transfer the law to the next generation. Got it? Yeah. What God did with you through the law may not be what he does for your children through the same law. So give your children the law, not your experience. Tradition is what you experience when you obey the law. Don't give your kids the tradition. Because the tradition is your experience. Once you teach your child the laws of God, and they leave your house and go to college, and you don't know where they are, you better hope the law stays intact. You know, my son and daughter, man, they're traveling, my daughter living far from me. I got to trust the laws we lay down in their hearts. Because law is what is stable, not your experience. And sometimes your experience, you shouldn't transfer to your kids. If you know what I'm talking about. I mean, you used to smoke dope. You can't tell your kid, but you know, you got to try it one time because, you know, you got to go through that. No, that's a bad tradition. How about this one? I got pregnant before I was married. And I want my daughter. No. You give the law. I violate the law. You keep the law. You remain celibate. Transfer the law. So traditions are dangerous because they are your experience and they become your custom that you learn when you encounter the law. But they may not be the same for the next generation. Is that clear? And this is why I think I told you in my last session, God is too creative to repeat himself. God never did the same miracle twice anywhere in the Bible. That's amazing. I said, how come he never did a miracle twice? Because he don't want the miracle to become a tradition. How do you raise the dead? Well, I don't know. It depends, eh? One time he walked into a room, the little girl was dead. He just simply talked to her. He says, you know, what is it? Talakumai, which means come forth. And she rose from the dead. Then he met another guy who was on his way to the funeral in a box. He touched the box, the little boy rose up. The next time he went to a cemetery, a guy was dead 3 days. He called the guy back. In other words, how do you raise a dead? I don't know. Too creative. How do you heal a person? Well, first he put mud, spit on the eye. He never done it before. Never did it since. He met another guy, just touched him. And then another guy, touched him twice. Another guy said, you go wash in the water. In other words, there's no tradition to heal the blind person. But the same power and the same law is at work. Let me tell you how good that is. What that means is how God plans to cancel your mortgage. See, now, according to your faith, be it unto you. How God planned to heal your body. It was about the Lord, you know, she prayed and God healed. This person prayed for you. I said, I get that same person, let them pray for me. No. God said, look, I want you to stop eating pig. Oh, I like group. God said, look, I can heal you if you stop eating too much fat. You don't want that way, right? God, I want the instant way. I don't want the long way. I got to eat my ribs. God says, no, I want you to be vegetarian for 3 years. But your system is messed up. If I heal you, you'll be sick again from what you eat. In other words, how does God heal? I like the word Jesus uses. Jesus says, you shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Now, recover could be a day, a month, 2 years, 5 years, 10 years. He left that word so wide. It could be instant, it could be a process, but you will recover. That's the good news. Hello? So we cannot dictate to God a tradition. This is why when you go to, you know, some organizations, some churches, they got such a strong tradition. God left that church a long time ago. Does he know something? I've been trying to get into that church, but they got them traditions locked down so tight, I can't get in myself. As a matter of fact, the book of Revelation talks about this. Jesus, when you read the book of Revelation, and by the way, pastors mess this up so badly. I'd repent too, because I used to do it. There's a scripture in the Bible that says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hears my voice and hearken to my voice and open up, I will come in and sup with him. Now, when you read that text, it has nothing to do with an unsaved person. The text has to do with the church. The text says that the seven churches were giving him problems. He says, and one of the churches was so locked down, they locked Jesus out. The chapter is about Jesus trying to get back into his own church. And he says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. Not the way them folks having a good time. Christ, I'm in there. I'm trying to get in. They got all their, you know, their regalia, all their rituals, all their incense, all the shouting, all the screaming, all the stuff. And people having a good time without God. Behold, I stand at the door and knock at my own church. And they said, if any man here, in other words, one person might hear him. He said, I'll come in and sup with who? With that person by himself. Him, he says, him. Sometimes you discover truth in the middle of a tradition and you can't stay. Because God visited you personally because you wanted more. Huh? Right? Yeah. And sometimes you wonder, why can't I go back to that church anymore? God said, because you discovered me. I supped with you. You ate my stuff privately. You got different diet now. You can't go back to that stuff. You can't eat that old stuff anymore. So it's tough for you to go back because you had an encounter with the one who you heard at the door. Tradition is dangerous. It can lock God up. Tradition is a killer. Because you can become so habitually attached to it that even though you know it ain't working, you still do it. And so these four words are important. Now, let me show you something here, very important here, how this works with some scriptures. I want to share with you for the next few moments God's eternal mandate. I call it the dominion mandate. What did God really want? And you got to understand this for me to close this session. God's plan was to establish a nation on earth. Remember I talked about that? Okay, let's read some scripture. Genesis chapter 9. Everyone turn there, please. Some verses you never saw before. Genesis chapter 9, verse 1 says, then God blessed Noah. By the way, I better give a context to this. We all know the first man that God created, his name was who? What was his name? I got to make sure you all said it. Adam, right? Okay, Adam. Now, Adam had everybody inside of him. And God went inside, took out a woman, he told him to multiply, and Adam began to release all these kids. And Adam lived 930 years, I think it is, 930 years. 930 years, and this guy had a lot of kids. A few of them we know. You know, Abel, Cain, Shem, rather. You know, we have a few kids, but he had a whole lot of kids. Now, we remember what happened with Adam's first generations, eh? The Bible said they became so evil. Because they what? Disobeyed God. What did they do to disobey God? Can you tell me? I think you better just read it because I want you to see the connection. Turn to Genesis chapter 3. Chapter 2, rather. Chapter 2. Genesis chapter 2. Genesis chapter 2, the Lord God, chapter 2, verse 15. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it, to care for it. And the Lord God did what? Verse 16. I can't hear you. Say it loud. I can't hear you. Okay, let's go back to that list again, eh? The command is what? A spoken law. God didn't even for the man to figure it out, you know, in his mind. God made it a command. Do not touch the tree. So he spoke it. Which means Adam got what from God? A word. Ladies and gentlemen, Adam had no written decree. All he had was what? A word from God. A word is a command. Now, the entire human race is hanging on a word. Adam could keep us in God's will or take us out of God's will simply by a command. The power of a command backed up by God. Don't touch the tree. What did Adam do? Adam violated the command. He broke the law. What is a command? A spoken law. Adam broke the law and everybody fell apart. The whole human race was kicked out of the garden. The human race became corrupt. And the Bible says that the sins of men were so filthy by the time Noah was born, it says that the stench of man's sin was in God's nostrils. What does God do? God says, I'm going to start over. Now, he doesn't start over by destroying the earth, because earth wasn't the problem. Earth is always innocent. You see that oil spill over there? He said, look, I ain't do you nothing. I have oil in my belly, you're punching my belly, oil come out. What's the deal? I'm innocent. Earth is always innocent. It is the humans on it. tell your neighbor, life would be good if you wasn't here. Lord, have mercy. Oh, Lord, that's a revelation for me. You know, some of y'all who married thinking, Lord, if this thing just go away, just for 2 weeks, I'll be okay. Listen, humans are God's greatest challenge. God got a problem with monkeys. God said, jump, monkey. Say, how high? Jump. God tell the fish, swim. How long? Swim. Tell man, do this. Why? They got to question, they got to discuss it. So now, man destroys the whole thing, right? What does God do? God makes a decision. He said, I'm going to clean off the earth. I destroy, this is my earth. Earth is the Lord's, it's mine. I'm going to clean it. I'm going to kill every one of the first specimen. And the Bible says this scripture, very important verse. It says, then the Lord blessed Noah. Now, the Lord called Noah. The reason why I want to read this is because you never saw this verse before. The same words God said to Adam, he said to Noah. I want you to see that. What does God say to Adam? Be fruitful, multiply, replenish, and fill the earth, and dominate the earth, the fish, the birds, the animals, the trees. He said, do all of that. Okay, same instructions. Now, watch it now. So God drowned all these people. He only has 8 people left. And God says, okay, tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to start over. And God says to Noah, let's read together. And the Lord God blessed Noah, come on now, and his sons, saying to them, be fruitful and multiply in number and fill the earth. The fear and the dread of you will fall upon all the beasts of the field and all the birds of the air and upon every creature that moves along the ground and upon all the fish of the sea. They are given into your hand. I mean, you get dominion over them. We're 3. Everything that lives and moves will be food for you. Just as I gave you the green plants, I now also give you everything else, which include meat. So the first time it's telling to me. Okay. Now, I want you to watch this. Look at that statement. Exactly the same thing he told Adam, right? That's my point. God has this one idea. And he refused to let the idea go. I want to have humans on the earth. They must dominate the earth. Notice, not dominate people. Dominate creatures, animals, plants, and resources on the earth. The same plan never changed. So God is what? Starting over again with a new group of people. 8 people. What does Noah do? Noah gets drunk. God says, oh no, man. Second time, I'm losing it again. The guy became alcoholic. Staggered all over the place naked. God says, man, wait a minute. I want to start again, but I got problems with humans again. Boy, God must really love you, eh? He knows all your mess and still will use you. Give him praise anyhow. Thank you, Lord. Man, he knows all of our stuff. He knows all of our weaknesses, all of our challenges. And God says, I'm still going to forgive you because I need you to work with me. So God says, okay, no, I can't use you anymore. What does God do? God then goes to his great-great-grandson. I want to read Acts chapter 17 for a second. Because Paul refers to this struggle God has. Because God wants to build this nation on earth out of man. Acts chapter 17, verse 26, turn there. It actually tells you, it says, from one man, God made every nation of men. From one what? Man. Adam. God made me. He's trying to get his right nation. He keeps trying to get the right nation. God only wanted one nation on earth, but the first one failed. He started to get a second one. The second one failed. He said, from one man, I'm still trying to get the right nation. Most of us want God to save us. God wants to save a nation. He wants a whole nation. Is this coming through? This is one of the reasons why Christianity is so weak. Because it's focused on individual salvation. Private redemption. It's like I'm saved, the rest can go to hell kind of thing. You know, I know God, you can go to hell kind of thing. But this spirit is not of God. He wants a whole nation to know him. He's after a nation. And so we find God saying, I, from one man, trying to get the right nation from that one man that they can what? Inhabit the whole earth. Remember we read that in the book of Isaiah 45. He said God made the earth to be inhabited. With what? His nation. I want to read another verse here. Let's go back to the Old Testament, Genesis 12. Then the Lord said to who? Abraham. Why?
Moses.
I mean, Noah messed up. Adam messed up. God started again. Noah messed up. Now God gonna start again. He said, okay, this is Noah's great-great-grandson, okay? God said, okay, let me try one more time. I'm going to call one man again. And he says to Abraham, leave your country and your people and your father's house and go to the land that I will show you. Verse 2, I will make you into a great nation. He wouldn't quit. I want a nation that looks like heaven. I'm not going to quit till I get it. You want to go to heaven? God said, no, I want you on earth. I want him to see what heaven is like on earth. And I want an entire people to have the same culture. That's the message of the Bible. He's trying for the third time. He said, Abraham, I'll make you a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. The word name great, that means I'll give you a reputation. The whole world, he says, watch this, he says what? All the nations of the world will be blessed through you. Ladies and gentlemen, God wanted to raise up a nation of people who were so distinctive, they'll become famous for being different. I will give you a reputation among all the nations that they will all want to be like you because you remind them of heaven. Read the next verse 3. I will bless those who bless you, curse those who curse you. I will curse them. All the peoples of the earth will be blessed through you. That word peoples, that means nations. All the nations of the earth. Now what does it mean by this? He says, look, I'm going to do this. God only knows one nation, you know. It's called the Adamic race. All these other nations that God we have, God don't know anything about these nations. One nation God has. And the first one failed, he tried to get one more. No. That one failed, they're trying now to get another one, Abraham. Did they fail? Absolutely yes. The Abrahamic nation failed. They became so corrupt, they intermarried with Canaanites, Moabites, Hittites, Jebusites. When they got into the land, they got corrupted. God says, I'm going to kill them all. And God drove them into Egypt. They failed. What's he after? A nation. Genesis 18. And the Lord said to Abraham's son, shall I hide from Abraham? I'd rather say Abraham. Should I hide from Abraham the things that I do? Abraham will surely become a great one, powerful nation, and all nations of the earth will be blessed through him. Now, please watch this for the next couple of seconds. Help me, Lord. I know this, but I can explain it. God has one nation. That nation failed. God tries to get another nation. But what did God do? God chooses a group of people to create a heavenly nation with. And then he says, I'm going to use this nation to be the catalyst for bringing all the other nations back to me so the whole earth could be filled with the knowledge of the kingdom of God. In other words, God calls out the nation of Israel so they can become a prototype of heaven on earth. So the other nations can be jealous. They see a nation with no sickness, no disease, no poverty, no corruption. You know, the marriages are together, the homes are together, the kids. He said, and they said, wow, what are they doing? We want to be like them. They failed. Instead of them becoming an example to the Canaanites, they married the Canaanite women. Instead of them becoming an example to the Jebusites and the Hittites and the Moabites and those who offered children on the altar, cut the children's throat and put the blood on the altar, they married their children. God says, what are y'all doing? When you read the Old Testament, God says, I will kill y'all. He got mad at them. He said, what are you doing? He said, you're like a harlot. He's talking to the whole nation of Israel. He says, you become like a prostitute, sleeping in the bed with the very people you're supposed to be an example to. By the way, my before I go home today, in the next few minutes, you're going to see the church has done the same thing.
The Christian church.
How can you tell a guy not to be homosexual when the preacher's homosexual? In other words, you sleep in the bed, you go howling. The reason why a lot of preachers don't preach the law of God anymore, they can't preach it. Why? They're breaking it. We were in Brasilia 2 days ago. 5,000 leaders in this auditorium in Brazil. And they called us up, my wife and I, to wish us happy anniversary of 31 years of marriage. And the people started clapping and cheering and shouting. And I saw some of them sitting there crying, just looking at us, weeping. And the Holy Spirit says, this should not be an exception. Tell people when I got married I was a virgin, they clap. Wow. That's a disaster. Young man, when being a virgin makes you special, our world is in trouble. The church claps when a young woman says she's a virgin. We have no more standards to show the world. I was talking to a marriage therapist this week, and he said, right in Brazil, he said, you know, the statistics now of divorce is equal in the church to the world. There's no difference between the world and the church with divorce anymore. That has to change. There's got to be a nation of people that becomes a standard. Which is what God wants. He says, I'll make you a distinction in the world, he says. That's why we keep the laws. Look at this. Genesis 35. And God said to him, I am God Almighty. Be fruitful and increase in number. A nation and a community of nations will come from you. And kings will come from your body. He's talking to Abraham. Look at the next verse, Exodus 19. Now God is speaking to him. Okay, now let's get the story right here. So the folks out of Abraham messed up. They became, you know, partners with pagans, Hittites, and Moabites, Canaanites. So God says, look, you all have failed me. I'm going to send you all into slavery. So they went into slavery. 430 years after they've been in Egypt, God raised up another man. Always raised up a man. Like, raised up one man, Moses. So we got Adam, Noah, Abraham. Now we got Moses. He's still trying what? To get a nation. What does he say to Noah? Let's read it. The Lord said, Noah, you go to Egypt and get slaves. Now what are slaves? We celebrate Emancipation Day tomorrow. A slave is a human that has no rights. They own nothing. They have right to no land, no property, no heritage, no history, no lineage, and no future. A slave is chattel. God says, I want to begin with slaves again. I want a group of folks who ain't got nothing, they are nothing, ain't got plans, they have nothing, ain't have nothing, ain't got nothing. In other words, I'm going to start again with zero again. Why? I want a nation. So let me wonder why we went for slavery. God's trying to strip us so he can start with fresh meat. Let me start with someone who don't know and ain't got nothing. You know what God told him? He said, I start with nothing, right? Watch. He said, started you with nothing. You had nothing. You had no name, no property, no history. And then he says, let me warn you, okay? When I take you into this land, don't forget me. God can tell them before you go, don't forget me. Look at the Bahamas, man. May the fathers live. Oh, we signed that in 1973. Tell the road we trod, listen to all economy. What happened to God? It's so easy to forget when you're in the land. You know, a little bit of wealth, you build your house over by the lake, you know, everything. Cool. I gotta go to church no more. My church stay too long, man. See, you know, this is God say, wait a minute. Wait 1 minute. God only gonna shift things like a little bit of oil spill and get some on your beach. These people were nothing. And God says, Moses, bring them out in the wilderness, watch him, to meet with me. That was the instruction. When they got out there, this is what he says, Exodus 19:5. Read. He says, although, come on, out loud, although the whole earth is mine, let's stop reading, let's stop reading. God said, look, although the whole earth, that means everything on the earth is mine, all the other people, all the other countries, all of it is mine. I ain't gonna choose anybody, he says. That what a statement means. I own the whole thing. So you ain't special. He's warning them. It's a privilege for me to choose you. Read the next statement. I am, he said what? You will be for me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation, not a holy person. This ain't individual. He wanted a group of people, everybody holy. The children, holy. Teenagers, holy. Young adults, holy. Adolescents, holy. Married, holy. Unmarried, holy. Age, holy. Grandfather, holy. Grandmama, holy. Old people, holy. Geriatric, holy. He said, I want a whole nation holy. Holy means distinctive, set apart. Sanctified means to be set apart for one specific use. God, I'm going to use you all as a model over here. So the other nations can see what it's like to be a kingdom community. That's the picture. He said, these are the words you have to say to these slaves. You know, I make a confession for years that God lives in my heart. You know, I believe them in all my heart. But that's a cry of hope. I'm hoping that when a tourist lands in this country, the first thing they will feel is the presence of God, not the presence of Junkanoo. That's my hope. My hope is when they walk down the street, they will hear people humming hymns in the stores. Not I want to see people experience the goodness and the joy of the Lord in the streets. Not crime. We sell our soul for a little bit of porridge. We are going in bed with Canaanites and speaking with Hittites just to get some money in our back pockets. We're sacrificing the faith that built our country for some finances that can't last. What God says, I want a holy nation. Our prime minister, whoever he or she may be, supposed to be holy. Our deputy supposed to be holy. The senator supposed to be holy. The members of parliament supposed to be holy. Lord, the judge is supposed to be holy. Every Supreme Court judge holy. Every lawyer holy. Every hotel manager holy. Every policeman, Lord help us, holy. Every defense force officer holy. Every teacher in the classroom holy. Every sports entertainer holy. Every businessman holy. Every businesswoman holy. What have we done? God wants a prototype. He's looking for a nation. Let me just show you how this works. Look at 1 Peter. Now you would say, that's the Old Testament. Let's see if he wants it for you. When Christ went to the cross, by the way, let me just say this. Let me go to the list again. We got what? Adam. Then we get who? Noah. Then we get who? Abraham, and then we have Moses, and they all failed. So God said, look, I ain't using man no more. I'm coming myself. Why? From one man, he has to make this nation from one man. So he sends one man, and you listen to me carefully. After Moses failed, the prophets took over. And the prophets kept on saying, the Lord himself shall give you a sign. The virgin shall be with child. His name shall be called Emmanuel. God is coming to be with us himself. For unto you a child will be born. As the prophet said, unto you a son will be given. And the government that you lost shall be upon his shoulders. His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor. Mighty God, come on, prophesy. Everlasting Father, prophesy. Prince of Peace. And of the end of his government there shall be no end. And it shall expand. He shall reign on the throne of David. He's coming. He's coming. And Malachi said, and just before he comes, there'll be one before his face announcing him. His name shall be John the Baptist. And John says, behold, the Lamb of God has arrived. And here comes Jesus, the last one. What does he come to get? A nation. Not a religious people. Now read 1 Peter. You just read. 1 Peter 2, verse 9. Read. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood. You are a holy nation. Read on. You belong to God, that you may declare and show forth the praise of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you used to be not a people, but now you are a nation of God. Once you had not received mercy, but he has forgiven you and cleansed you. But he won a whole nation. He's looking for a group of people. You know, someday, live in a coffin right here. I'm going to be here and I won't be able to say a word to you. But you got to remember this. This is not about you personally and individually. I'm believing God that before I die, there'll be a group of people who look just like heaven on earth in the Bible. I believe in God's dream. People in this church come to me and say, there's some folks in the church who got marital problems. You know, and I think, what else can I tell them? I can't talk to you no more. I preach marriage principles all my life. I got books in there, CDs. I got stuff. What's your problem? You won't apply and practice. So you want to waste my time all over again? You want a private sermon? I already preach. I'm tired, man. I'm traveling. I'm tired. Live right. Do right. He's looking for a people who are distinctive, who forgive one another, who don't hurt their spouses, who don't say dumb things to their spouses, who don't beat one another, who don't molest children, who don't commit adultery, who don't fornicate. He's looking for a people who live clean and holy. Coming here don't make you holy. That's your personal responsibility to obey the law. The last part, verse 10. Once you were not a people, he says, but now you are a people. He said, man, you used to be, you know, like the other folks, but you are different now. You're not supposed to be like them. You're supposed to be the example for them, the prototype for them, the model for them. He wants a nation that people can say, I want to be like that. That's what God said. This verse, Deuteronomy 4, verse 6, read. Now, I want to show you what I call the distinctiveness of law. But this is what I want to close this on. Okay. scripture saw that God was a nation. Any arguments there? No. We see it all through, right through the entire Bible. Okay. Now the question is, how do you build a nation? That's the question. The answer is simple. And the Bahamas needs to learn it, and so does America, and Jamaica, and Guyana, and Haiti. All nations. Let's read this. God's Moses, bring him out. Moses brought him out. What would a God, who did Moses bring out? A bunch of broke, empty, naked people. The money they had was given to them. So here they are in the desert. God said, okay, Moses, you're going to start the nation. What is the first act of God? The first act of God to start a nation is he makes an appointment with them. You read the Bible. He says, now tell them to meet me at 3 o'clock tomorrow, he says, at a certain mountain. He said, Moses, tell the men to put a barricade around the mountain. He says, and tell all the people, oh Jesus, including the children, he says, tell everyone to wash their clothes. His instructions. And tell them to wear clean clothes, and I want all the people to come to the mountain. Instruction. So, Moses, yes, Lord. Moses went back, told the people, wash your clothes, 3 o'clock tomorrow, be on time, we're going to gather, we're going to meet with God. By the way, God keeps time. Where you being for 9:30? Anyhow. So, here we go. God says, all right. So the people came the next day, right? Everybody was dressed up, clean, ready to meet God. Children, teenagers, everybody. God wants to meet with the whole nation personally. I was there, they were waiting. Suddenly, there was thunder. Then there was lightning. Then it says the earth began to shake. Then it says the mountain began to rumble. And the thunder grew louder as the Lord's presence descended upon the mountain. It says the people became afraid. They were behemoth. Lightning thunder be going in the bed. And the Bible says the people became so afraid, they ran away from the mountain back to their tents. Went inside, zipped it up, locked themselves in their tents. Now, I don't know how the tent is protected from the thing, but anyhow, they were so afraid, the Bible says they hid themselves. And they told Moses on their way, while they're running, they said to Moses, you see it for yourself. And the Bible said when the Lord came down to meet with the people, there was only Moses. Now, the principle. What's the principle for what? First law. The first law is God didn't want anyone to represent you. That's the principle you missed. He wanted to meet you personally. My job is really temporary. God doesn't want me to be doing what I'm doing right now. I'm going to prove that before this series. God's going to get rid of pastors and prophets and get rid of them. Because that's never his plan. You don't need a prophet to talk to you about God or for God. He will talk to you himself. So Moses ran. I mean, the people ran. Most of the, and the Bible says, and the Lord God came down and said, Moses, where are the people? And Moses and the Lord, the people, they said, Lord, the people were afraid of thee. And they fled. Then the Lord said unto Moses, come thou up unto the mountain, that I may speak with you. God never wanted to speak to Moses. Now, what's he going to say to Moses? Exactly what he wanted to say to the children, the teenagers, and the adults. What does he say? He gives him these 10 principles. getting ready to build a nation, he begins with law.
What makes the church such a mess? Individuals breaking the laws of God. Those 10 laws that God gave Moses are running every nation today.
Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not murder. Thou shalt not covet. Thou shalt not bear false witness. Thou shalt not work 7 days a week and kill yourself.
Every nation tries to follow them, but will never admit where they got them from.
God's building a nation, he starts with law. Now, I want you to read this verse, because this verse tells you how important the law is to a country. It also tells you what God was after. Ready? Deuteronomy 4:6. Read together. Go. Observe them carefully, for this will show your wisdom and understanding to who? The other nations, who will hear about all these decrees, and they will say about you, surely that great Bahamian nation is wise and understanding. What other nation is so great as to have their God near them the way the Lord our God lives in the Bahamas? And whenever we pray to him, he hears us. And what other nation, underline it, is so great as to have such righteous decrees and laws as this body of law? I have said it before you today. He said, what's going to distinguish you is this body of laws. Not just shouting and singing and preaching and fall on the ground. He said, we're going to make you different if you have some laws that create a new culture. What will distinguish you, he says, from the other nations is these decrees you keep you for. He didn't say grace will distinguish you. The laws will distinguish you. Wouldn't it be great to be married to a man who just keeps the laws of God? That means you ain't got to work the way he is at 3 o'clock in the morning. Problem is, we got folks who just don't keep the law. They don't know who to trust. Business people, Lord have mercy. They need the law of God bad. The Bible said, thou shalt not steal, man. If I took your money to buy something for you, I should bring it to you when I finish. I shouldn't use it to do something else. Not stealing. And they tell me, because I was your brother, you can wait a couple of years once I do pay back. You need to get beaten with a baseball bat. Lord, forgive me, please. But just keeping the law, just keeping your word, it's simple. Christ says, let your yea be yea, let your nay be nay. Mama. He says, anything more than that is what? Evil. That means you should never say maybe. You never say maybe. It's either yes or no. You can do it or you ain't going to do it. Don't lie to me. It's a law. Just keeping your word distinguishes you. I promise to love you, cherish you, and tell death to his part. All she has is my word. Can you keep it? Can you keep your word to your wife? You don't want me to trust them with my vote. And they got 3 hours. And I said, now wait a minute. You promised to buy me a road, give me this, give me that. But you can't even keep your word to your own spouse. Let me tell you something. The election's coming up soon. Listen to your pastor. When they come to your house, invite them in. Come right in. Sit down. Give them a cup of coffee and everything. And then ask them some questions they can't answer. Who do you speak with all the time? Are you straight? Oh, this is serious business. Ask them. I heard some things about you. Are you straight? Because I ain't voting for none. I keep my vote. In other words,
we need some distinction. Any member of this church who goes into politics, I don't care what party they are in. If you know their character, their testimony, you vote for them. Even if it's against your own party, let me tell you why. You want righteousness in them. Says, when the righteous rule, the people rejoice. But when the wicked is in power, same verse, the people groan. Boy, there's some groaning in the Bahamas. This party thing got to stop. We need a righteous nation. We need righteous leaders. And you can't get a righteous man if he does not come from righteous seed. Don't confuse a nice person with a righteous person. A lot of nice people in the world. He says, this law shall separate you from the other nations. This body of law will make you different. If we live right, they should say, wow, you know, I hope the day comes soon when they'll say, hire anybody from BFM because they clean, they don't steal, and they're honest, they get character. Right now, I don't do it right now. I said there's some work to do. But I pray the day will come when you'll get this message in your spirit. There'll be a distinction between you and the other nations. We'll close with this, write this down, please. God is the God of law. That's why you gave law first. God's divine laws are inherent. They're built in. They're principles. God's divine laws are never canceled. They're always present. God's divine laws are also eternal. No one can change them. God's divine laws are not tradition. Because your experience of them keeps changing. God's divine laws are given to protect, not to destroy, not to restrict. Tradition restricts us, but not the laws of God. They give us freedom within the context of law. There can never be law without freedom, and no freedom without law. God's divine laws are permanent, so grace doesn't cancel them. Traditions are temporary, but God's laws are eternal. And the big question we need to ask ourselves, question. Is there any of the Ten Commandments that are now irrelevant? The answer is no. In our succeeding sessions from here, we're going to go to those Ten Commandments and see them again for the first time. Some of our teenagers never saw the Ten Commandments, but they don't read the Bible. Some of you adults forget the Ten Commandments. You can't quote all of them. And the Bible says the law of God must be in your heart. Heart means mind. You can't even know, remember where they are. How can you obey them? They are all valid. They are still relevant. And until we get this in our spirit, that we have to follow God's laws, we will always be compromising with the world. It's so wonderful to meet someone who would say to the world, I don't do what you are doing. I follow higher law. What is a beautiful sound? I can't do that. That's below my laws. What a beautiful sound.
scripture was read today stuck in my mind. I want you to turn that scripture really close to that scripture. Remember the scripture? Psalm 112. I want you to read that. Get your Bibles and read it. Everybody say, I love the Lord God. If any man loves the laws of God, he shall be preserved. It's a beautiful verse of scripture. Psalm 112, get it? What's the first verse? Praise the Lord. Everybody say, praise the Lord. Say it like you really mean it now. Praise the Lord means give thanks to the owner. The next statement. Blessed is the man who fears the Lord. Why? He delights in his commands. What is command? Stated laws. Blessed is the man who fears the Lord. He delights in his commands. Delight means what? To enjoy the laws of God. Isn't that beautiful? I love the laws of God so much. You delight in them. You enjoy them. Can your husband enjoy your friends, ladies? Can your wife enjoy the friends you keep? Or you keep them at distance because they're not the right friends for their family? I mean, what do you delight in the Lord? Enjoy doing right. David says, if you delight in his law, because you want, you fear disappointing him. The fear of God doesn't mean you are scared of God. It means you are afraid to disappoint your father. You don't want to hurt your father's feeling. You don't want your father to be disappointed in all of his expectations of you. You're afraid to embarrass your daddy. That's the kind of fear you need. I couldn't do this, son, because my daddy would be embarrassed. I can't sleep with you. I'm going to hurt my father's feelings. I'm afraid to hurt him. Do you love him so much you're afraid to hurt him? Love always brings that fear of hurting. If you love your wife, you will do everything to make sure she's not hurt. And you know what makes us hurt better at all? When they are hurt. Boy, it hurts, eh? When your wife is hurt, you feel sick. Especially if you cause the hurt. Because love doesn't want to disappoint. It's a good kind of fear. If you fear the Lord, you will delight in what? His commands. Next verse. And your children will be mighty in the land. If you obey the laws of God, first of all, God says, I'm going to fix your kids. We'll be right back.
Somebody shout there.
I call this the benefits of the law. If you obey the law, your kids gonna come out right. That's what he's talking about. The law of God first affects your house. Why? You're building a community, remember? You build a nation. The nation begins right in the house. Our prisons are filled with young men and a few women who came from homes where the law of God cannot be found. So they become community dangerous elements. I will bless your children. What's the next one? The generation of the upright will be blessed. Verse 3. Wealth and riches. Oh, I claim that right now. Now, by the way, now, you got to stay in touch with verse 1, though. Money coming. I'm blessed. Oh, really? Check verse 1 first. My God shall supply. Yes, but did you check verse 1? If you obey my laws, he says, wealth and riches will be where? In your house. Now, two different words. Let me talk about that. You know, wealth and riches are two different things, right? Riches is hard cash. You can lose that. Wealth is good ideas. You can't never lose that. If you obey my laws, no matter how they fire you, you can still find something else better. Why? They can't take away your wealth. They can take away your riches, but not your wealth. I'm going to give you both, he says. Ideas to start a business in your own house. What an idea. Get up in the morning, just walk over to your business. Instead of being a slave around, other people tell you what to do with that. Ideas. That's wealth. What's the next one? Your righteousness shall endure what? Forever. Righteousness means staying in line with the law. He said, you'll always, he said, once you feel how sweet it is, you get wealth all the time. Righteousness, he said, man, you ain't never going to disobey God. He said, I'm going to stay right in the righteousness of God right now. I ain't never going to disobey the Lord. Why? Man, there's benefits. But what's the next benefit? I love this one. He said, unto the upright, there arises light and darkness. Okay. This one I really felt this morning when I read this. Pastor Richard, God says, if you keep my law, when it is dark, when nothing seems to be working, they shut down the company, shut down the business, they lay you off, everything dark. God says, if you keep my law, just keep saving the law, he said. He says, in the middle of the darkness. What do you say, brother? He says, when everything seems to be crisis, he says, crisis. In the middle of the darkness, you're going to just emerge. Bright light is on the way. They can't keep a good man down. You shall arise out of darkness, and bright light shall shine. Today is the best day of your life because you are law-abiding citizens.
Thank you once again for listening to this message, as we hope that it has been a blessing to you. Our goal is to show you new paths and opportunities so that you can discover your purpose. It is your love, support, and partnership that makes Munroe Global possible. Please visit us online at www.munroeglobal.com for more product, partnership, or to join us at one of our live events around the world.